most enjoyable memory of your career with the New Orleans Saints?
Well, I had a lot of great memories with the Saints. You know, of course, I threw six touchdown passes against St. Louis one time, and Dolly Johnson threw six, and we own the league record of 12 in one game. But I guess the biggest and greatest thrill I had is when Dusty kicked that 63-yarder, which everybody still remembers.
And he still remembers that you made the completion of Alan Dodd with 2 seconds to even get him in position.
Nobody else tried. I drew, you know, and I drew that play up on the sand of the thing because I just said, Al, you go down there. And I drew it up. He said, go right out there and turn out. And I said, now don't go more than 20 yards because I can't hit you.
Billy, thank you very much.
Thanks, Billy. Buddy. Good seeing you, pal.
Okay, a tap time with the...
Well, it's no secret, one of Buddy's favorite sports personalities of all time was Hank Stram. And here's a brief snippet of Hank Stram talking to Buddy going into Super Bowl 36, which happened to be in New Orleans in January of 2002.
Hank Stram, who was the winning coach in the first Super Bowl played in New Orleans, the Kansas City Chiefs upsetting the Minnesota Vikings. And, Coach, thank you very much for joining us. And that was a game, to me, was the signature game in Super Bowl history, simply because it gave the AFL, and it was the last AFL game, an identity, hey, that they were ever, you know, they deserve every bit to stand shoulder to shoulder with the NFL.
Yeah, well, that's a good observation. Buddy, because, you know, everybody called us the Mickey Mouse League and all kinds of stuff, you know. And and then they didn't even give the Jets the kind of credit they deserved by winning the Super Bowl free. They won the game, and they said that was a fluke, you know. And so as a result, why, you know, we felt very proud to be able to come in there, and we were 24-point underdog, according to... Jimmy the Greek, and we wound up winning the game, and so we, you know, it endorsed what we felt about solidifying and making people realize that our league was on an equal basis with the National Football League.
Coach, I don't know about Jimmy the Greek, but actually, in reality, you all were between a 12 and 13 point underdog, which is a, you know, it's a double digit underdog, but it wasn't 24. Let me ask you, Hank Stram now, of course, lives across the lake and stayed in the New Orleans community after coaching the New Orleans Saints, and he's got a system on handicapping Super Bowl games that's been very successful. Hank, this is a game that you got a 14-point favorite. You got some people who think it's going to be a blowout. You got others who think it's going to be a competitive game without particular thing. What is your system showing? Kind of recap it for us and tell us what the conclusion is.
Well, you know, I was kind of flabbergasted because before I put the chart together, it looked like that it would be very, very difficult for New England to win the game, you know. And then when I broke it down into categories, there are 74 categories altogether, and it goes on offense and defense. And I was kind of overwhelmed to think, after looking at the whole thing and checking all the pluses and all the minuses and all that kind of stuff, to quickly give it to you. On offense, the Patriots have 19 pluses, okay? And on the other side of the ball, why, the Rams have plus 16 pluses, okay? On defense, the New England team has 18 pluses, so 18 and 19 makes it a plus 37 for the two categories. On the other side, there's only there's plus 6 for the Rams on defense, and so they got 16 up above, 6 there. So their score is plus 22.
Well, what you're saying, Hank, is that on your system, you give New England a real chance to win the game straight up.
Right. That's exactly right. It's plus 37 to plus 22. And of course, the other thing you got to take into consideration is, you know, the Raiders, like Al Davis says, the Raiders, everybody expected them to win that game in New England, and they beat the Raiders. It was an unusual call at the end, but they won the game. And then last week, why, Pittsburgh was heavily favored to beat New England again, and they wound up beating them, too.
Well, I tell you what, New England, since they lost the first two games of the season, they 12-3-1 against the point spread in the last 16 games, 13-3 straight up. So that's a good live underdog. Hey, I'm encouraged. Donovan's system, which I know he had a lot of success, sort of indicates not only will it be a competitive game, but we could have a major upset.
Of course, it's no secret there were times Buddy was very outspoken when it came to mistakes the Saints had made. And listen to some of his post-game comments after the Saints lost rather lopsidedly to the Indianapolis Colts on September 28, 2003.
It was the biggest embarrassment in the history of the Saints. Yes, I know they were 1-15 in 1980 and didn't win a game until the second of last game of the season. But even that team didn't quit on the Colts like this one quit on Jim Haslett tonight, especially on defense. The Superdome was three quarters empty before the third quarter was over. Some fans started wearing bags on their heads. It was so bad, it was obscene. If it had been horse racing, they'd put up the inquiry sign. If it was boxing, the fight would have been stopped and the loser disqualified for lack of effort. Tom Benson earlier this week said, "Keep the faith, this is a good football team." Benson's a Catholic, and maybe he should go to confession after that statement. The 55 points were the most scored on the Saints in the Benson's 19 years of ownership. It was a second to only to the 62-7 defeat administered by the Atlanta Falcons in the opening game of 1973 at Tulane Stadium. But at least there was some sort of excuse. J.D. Roberts was fired during preseason, and John North inherited the mess a week before the season opener. After that game, Falcons owner Rankin Smith urinated on the hedges outside of Tulane Stadium, the Willow Street entrance. Yes, he was inebriated. I witnessed it. I suspect some fans feel like relieving themselves tonight. Some of the statistics were obscene. Peyton Manning set an all-time coach record with 6 touchdown passes. Manning was 20 of 25 for 314 yards and 6 touchdowns, and that was in 3 quarters. Wide receiver Marvin Harrison averaged 26.3 yards on 6 catches, 3 of them for touchdowns. These type of statistics are mute testimony to a team quitting on its coach. Besides the loss, the Saints lost to Bucky Jones, Wayne Gandy, Michael Lewis, with Charles Bentley, and Kenny Smith with various injuries. They may have been the fortunate ones. The only thing to be thankful for tonight is that this performance didn't happen in Saddam Hussein's Iraq. Otherwise, they would have had hands cut off and many put into the torture chambers. Thank God it's America.
And here's a brief snippet from 1995. Buddy making fun of a rumor.
And listen, there is no truth to the rumor that Tom Benson has contacted astronaut Jim Lovell about being the general manager. It's just that, a rumor.
You know, sometimes some of the people Buddy criticized over the years, he could be real friendly with, especially after they retired. And a couple of examples of that, this is from March of 2002. First, Buddy talks about the possibility of Ricky Williams getting traded away from New Orleans, but he also talked to Jim Mora and Frank Warren, who are going to be inducted into the Saints Hall of Fame later that year.
The Ricky Williams trade won't happen today, won't happen tomorrow, but it probably will happen before the end of the week, and Cleveland and Miami remain the two teams most interested, but I think it's going to happen. Today, Jim Mora and former defensive lineman Frank Warren were the new inductees into the Saints Hall of Fame. They were announced today. The actual installation will be in November. And because of all of Ricky Williams' trade talk, I asked Jim Moore to reflect on draft day 1999 when at Indianapolis they had a pick high to the Saints, and you know what happened.
Well, we had a high regard for both Ricky and Edson, and we were going to take a running back because we just traded Marshall Faulk a day before, I think it was, or that day, I'm not even sure. But so we knew we needed a running back, and so we were going to take probably either or that or make some kind of a trade, and there wasn't trade with the Saints involved, but probably going to take either Ricky or Edson, and we put almost as much work into that decision as we did the year before when we had to pick either Peyton or Ryan Leaf. It's not quite as much, but we had a high regard for both players. We liked them both. We both felt like they were going to have great careers, but it just came down that we felt like for our system, Edgren suited it a little bit better than Ricky did, but I liked Ricky a lot.
At this moment in time, with the hindsight, you all think you made the right decision?
Yeah, I think we made the right decision. We definitely made the right decision with Peyton. And as far as Edgren and Ricky, you know, only time tells over that deal. And Ricky had some injury problems his first couple of years in the league. Edgren got hurt last year and missed most of the season. But I think if both stay healthy, they both have, excellent careers ahead of them.
And I talked to Frank Warren about the importance of veteran leadership in the locker room.
Well, first of all, thank you. And yes, it's very important to have some type of leadership. You usually look to your veterans, the guys that's been there and know what it takes, you know, to be successful for leadership. But sometimes it comes from younger guys. It's a matter of being mature and learning how to handle situations. Sometimes, you know, things in the locker room, they get a little out of hand, and players can take things personal. And you have to remember that. You're in it as a team. It's not an individual sport. And certain sacrifices you have to make for yourself and also for your teammates. And, and that's when being a veteran comes into play. Having been there and know what works and what doesn't work, you know.
When you were there, you were one of the leaders on the team. Who were some of the other locker room leaders? And do you remember any examples of how it had a positive effect?
Well, we had a team that grew together. The team that I played on, a lot of us got drafted together in 1981. So we had, you know, a team full of leaders. And we kind of grew into that role together. And, we knew that, you know, there's no way that we could win as an individual, that it took a team effort. And that, you know, we inspired each other during the off season to go out and work out, be in the best shape possible. And, when we're off the field, you know, not to stay out too late in bars and whatever, you know, to get home responsible. You know, you go out and enjoy yourself, or you come home, you know, and get your rest and things like that. You know, you have a substitute, a couple of players not going to listen to you.
Of course, you know, Buddy was known to be a comedian at times, and here from his television show in 1994 is a parody of It's a Wonderful Life, where Buddy pretends he wished he had never been born. Steven Tyler plays the voice of the angel. And the other voices you'll hear will be Ken Trahan and Vince Marinello.
It's frustrating. So frustrating. 28 years of practically the same thing. Another losing season for the Saints. Still not a playoff win. People who were born 28 years ago now have kids in school. And still the Saints haven't reached the next level. Oh, how frustrating. Nothing I've said made a difference. They don't listen. They don't listen. I wish I had never been born.
You wish you'd never been born? Okay, buddy. You've got your wish.
Live from the foot of Canal Street, it's Hey Kenny T.
When it comes to talking football, Kenny T's the best.
Don't think what I like is Kenny T.
Always got a figure, always got a fact.
Larry, just
when he
of the Saints' encouraging 2-14 season. Kenny profiles strong-armed Saints quarterback Steve Wall. Plus, Kenny, Vince, and Saints head coach J.D. Roberts will take calls from viewers at home tonight on Hey Kenny T.
Hey Kenny T.
Only professional wrestler in the Saints ever drafted? That's wonderful. Paul Orndorff.
Hey Kenny T.
Only tight end from Notre Dame other than Irv Smith to play for the Saints? Greg Knoppel. And a pleasant good evening, and welcome once again to Hey Kenny T. I'm Ken Trahan.
Kenny T. Yeah, he skews a little bit younger, don't you think?
The Saints improved their winning percentage by 50% over last year. They went from one win to two.
Well, it proves what I said all along, Kenny, that John Meekham Jr. has never really gotten the credit.
Meekham's the owner?
Hey, he went around to harass him before he stayed. Besides, the players love him.
Always history have not one head coach, but two. He brings back J.D. Roberts. He elevates Carl Smith.
J.D. Robinson, Carl Smith, co-head coaches.
Hey, do your favorites, buddy.
But it shows that John's always thinking, and I think the future is bright for this football team.
Very innovative, and when you've got Dick Schwenk overlooking everything as general manager, I think this organization is looking in the right direction.
Tootie Robbins coming in at the start of the season, or start of next season. They're going to bring him in, get rid of William Roach.
Tootie Robbins, the stationary bicycle king.
Hey, Brad Muster was lonely.
I think smart moves to let go of Wayne Martin to bring in Sean Knight, and also, as you alluded to let go of William Roach and bring in Tootie Robbins. I know you enjoyed that flight to Denver, first class on John Meekham's plane.
That's the way Meekham's always treated the media, first class. You sit in the front. He and the coaching staff and players all sit in the back. And that's just John's way of handling it.
Without question, today's game was another thriller. And when I look at today's game against the Broncos, I got to tell you, I watched this thing with great interest. I was nervous the whole time. And I have to rate this game as a two yoo-hoo, yoo-hoo game. I get paid to do this. Yoo-hoo. It's got bark, baby.
Yoo-hoo. What happened to bark?
Hey, you ain't around to tell people how much bite it has. We'll be back with more of Hey Kenny T right after this.
Let's get out of here. Let's take my Lakeside Toyota and go to Star Casino.
Sorry, buddy, there is no Star Casino. Mayor Singleton thought of that.
Jim Singleton's mayor?
When he tells it like it is, he may be hard to understand, but hey, buddy D, he's the man.
Oh, man, what a mistake. I should have never said. Should have never been born. Oh, please forgive me. Man, Meekham, Benson, Tootie Robbins. I can't take it. I can't take it.
Another example of Buddy's humor aside, this is from also his television show in 1995, as he has Dr. Morgus on his show, with an appearance by Topsley and Vince Marinello about how Topsley could help the Saints turn their losing streak around.
Dr. Morgus, the magnificent? Well, let's get him on. Dr. Morgus is trying to call us?
Yes. Hello, buddy.
Hello, Dr. Morgus. It's great to hear from you.
I don't have much time, buddy. In fact, I'm getting ready for an important operation. Of course, you'll read about
it tomorrow. What kind of an operation?
I'm performing the world's first appendix transplant. All right? It's never been done before. Appendix transplant. Of course, that's not why I called you, buddy. Believe me, I've got something else that's really big. And it's coming to the Saints. But before I tell you this, and by the way, please don't tell anybody. Don't break this to the public yet.
Well, Dr. Morgus, they got people listening right now.
Well, look, there probably aren't too many of them out there anyway listening. but look, buddy, seriously, I'm telling you, buddy, tell those people whatever they're going to hear from me right now, do not pass it out of the house.
Please, this is a special request from Dr. Morgus. If you listen, don't repeat what he said.
Oh, that's great, buddy. Now, look, here it is. This is big stuff, buddy. This past week, I'll tell you the truth here, I got a call from Jim Mora. He's interested, buddy, in making a deal to get Chopsley signed with the Saints.
What?
That's right.
What did Mora say?
Well, he said that he thinks Chopsley can open up the hole for the runners. Okay, and of course, hey, listen to this. He wanted to take Chopsley for dinner to Antoine's.
Hey, Ben.
Well, Chopsley wouldn't go because, well, they don't have a salad bar, so he wouldn't go. But anyway, would you believe he came over to the lab, buddy? He tried to get Chopsley to sign some kind of a contract.
Oh no, wait! Don't let him do that. Don't let him do that.
Well, that's why I called you, buddy. In fact, Chopsley's on his way over to the station right now. In fact, he should be there right now. I want you to look it over. Look over that contract and then tell us what to do, okay?
I'll be glad to do that because I'll guarantee you, Dr. Morgus, you got to be careful about what they... Hello, Chopsley.
How are you?
Chopsley? All right, now, Dr. Morgus wants me to look at this contract, Chopsley. Let me take a look at this contract.
Let me just get out of the way.
Let me take a look at this contract.
Take a good look.
All right. I, Chopsley, being of sound mind and body, hey, this sounds like a last will, agree to the following terms and conditions set forth by the New Orleans Saints Incorporated. Number one, I agree to play the positions of offensive tackle, I agree to play the position of defensive tackle, and I agree to be the place kicker and the punter. That'll help the salary cap. Number two, I agree to play for a weekly salary of $1,000 to be paid only in the weeks that the Saints win? They snookered you there. Number three, I agree to remove the cloth bag that I wear over my face. Never, never, chopstick. Number four, after practice, I agree to work evenings in the services of Mr. Tom Benson as his chauffeur, butler, and bodyguard. Number five, I agree to work during the off-season as a car salesman at Benson Auto World. And number six, an incentive bonus. For and in consideration of the above services, an incentive bonus of in the amount of $5 million will be given to the undersigned should the Saints play in the Super Bowl come January. Chopsley, that's ridiculous. I'm not telling you anything. You can't sign anything like that, Chopsley.
Fine, Chopsley.
That's all right, Chopsley. No. Look, whatever you do, Chopsley, first of all, you don't get paid unless the Saints win, so you may never get paid the whole season. The $5 billion, if they get to the Super Bowl, that's like having nothing. Nothing, because there's no chance of them going to the Super Bowl. Listen, I got the Buddy D agency for budding athletes, and I guarantee you, we can get you a much better contract than Dr. Marcus, I'm surprised.
Wait a minute, Chopsley. Don't you sign anything with Buddy D, okay?
No, wait a minute.
You work for me, Chopsley.
Chopsley, how much does Dr. Marcus pay you? No wonder he drew this thing up. You mean Dr. Marcus doesn't pay you anything, Chopsley?
He took a vow of poverty.
Vow of poverty? This contract sounds like a vow of poverty. He only gets paid when they win, and he gets a $5 million bonus only if they go to the Super Bowl.
Chopsley, don't sign anything. Look, buddy, if you have that man sign anything, I'm going to call my attorney, Boris Bart.
Listen, Dr. Marcus.
Call Johnny Cochran.
Dr. Marcus, I love you, Dr. Marcus. But whatever you do, Dr. Marcus, we got to reorganize this. I'll take care of it for you. I'll take care of Chopsley.
Wait a minute. Chopsley, you hear me? Get back over here. Don't sign anything with that man. I'm going to get my attorney. Don't cut me off.
Oh, he's gone. Chopsley, we're going to go to a break, and I'm going to talk to you about this thing.
Well, of course, Dr. Morgan's appeared on Buddy's radio show back in late October of 2003, so let's hear a snippet of that.
And now, it is my privilege to welcome Marcus the Magnificent. Just like they used to bring Nash Roberts out of retirement every time a hurricane approached, because Nash had earned that respect over the years. Now we bring Marcus the Magnificent out of semi-retirement to see if there's something he can suggest to get the Saints to play better defense, something to help with stronger talent evaluation instead of being always enamored by the eyeball test, instead of evaluation, not looking inside the heart, the attitude, the football intelligence. Marcus, thank you very much. And by the way, how's Chopsley getting along?
Hey, buddy, turn your radio down. Yeah. Chopsley's trying to listen, will you? I'll tell you, buddy, you know, I worry about you, but by the way, who is your heart surgeon?
Dr. Duranda.
Well, I'll tell you what, I'm going to have you come up there for a checkup. You look like you're too excited when I'm listening to you. Man, how old? You must be 80, 85 years old.
No. It seems like it after coming to Saints for 38 years, but I'm really not, you know?
Well, listen, take it easy, you know. You're not 22 anymore, you know.
I know, Chopsley, but let me say to you, in my lifetime, I want to see some type of change, and you're the only one. I remember at one time when the Saints were really hurting at quarterback. You had a guy like Jim Everett with the arm. You had a guy like Bobby Abel with the moxie and the team leadership. Would you suggest that you and Chopper were going to put together a deal where you were going to take each part from each guy and make a real quarterback? You know, and you were going to keep them on life-preserving machines and everything. Take Bobby Abear's heart. Take Jim Everett's arm. I remember it was a brilliant idea.
Well, you know, of course, we're in the 21st century now. What the heck is that? Is that your wife or your brother?
No. I'm here. It must be some sound effects back at the stuff. Well, what is that? I don't know. Oh, I know what it is. Somebody just lost at the slot machine.
Well, listen, buddy, listen. I don't know what... Did you see the game last night?
I mean, Chopsy, that's asking me like, is today Monday?
Well, I tell you what, Chopsy and I watched it. I'm telling you, I just don't know. I mean, you know, we saw quite an ending there, did we? I mean, we saw something good until something bad happened, right? So it wasn't too bad. It wasn't too good, but it wasn't too bad, like I told Chopsy.
You know, you almost sound like some of the fans, they almost like they satisfied with average. And I know that's not you, Marcus.
No, listen, you know, let's be fair with these guys. We have a great team in this city, you know. It's only the other teams that come in here and cause a problem. Believe me. that's what part of it's about. I was thinking, buddy, tell that clown to shut up, will you? Well, this isn't a comedy hour, for heaven's sake.
No, we're serious.
Oh, boy, I can't help this. Buddy, I think you need more help than the team.
Well, let me say, have you at any time offered your services? Because, you know, I think there's a lot of Johnny come lately into the organization, and they probably don't even know who in the hell Marcus is, or Chopsy, and things like that. But basically, you know, have you in any way, shape, or form offered to help, even though they didn't accept it?
Yes, I could, buddy. You know, we could start off by reading one of my old books. You know, my famous book, New Hope for the Dead. That would be a...
Hey, if I could get very pretty.
Well, I would get them to read that, believe me. That would bring some life into them, but... I'm not talking about anything like steroids or...
No.
Oysters or anything like that.
Oh, that Ricky Williams stuff, no. Absolutely.
No, I've got a new medicine here. It's a non-drug. It's called Milk of Magnesia. And brother,
Milk of Magnesia, very, very catchy name.
Well, I'm telling you, it'll turn them on, buddy. But I really want to get to the real solution, because when... Oh, man, we ought to send that guy over there. He'd scare the heck out of him. Buddy, it sounds like you... Where are you, Casino Magic, or are you at a circus?
No, we Casino Magic in Bay St. Louis, man. You know, you always have a good time over here on Monday nights during the football season. But you said something that really caught my attention. You said there is a solution. And so I was almost getting to the point there. I didn't think there was any solution as long as you had... you know, the present ownership.
Buddy, if you will shut up, I'll give you the solution. Chopsy, are we going to cut it down, Chopsy? I'm getting a feedback, buddy. You know, science is really the answer. I'm trying to help you guys. And you know, buddy, and I know, and any sportsman knows, the whole deal is how much time the quarterback has in the pocket, right? Isn't that
okay.
The situation? Right. And we never give Aaron Brooks enough time in the pocket, and I've got the solution. I've had it here. I tried to offer it to them. We're not giving enough time. I've come up with a way. A quarterback needs at least 30 seconds in the pocket. If we could give a quarterback like Brooks 30 seconds, you know what that guy could do with that arm of his? He has a gun. Buddy, this has never been... Don't tell everybody, because the other teams could be listening. We take that front line, okay? The offensive line. The guys grab arms, they backpedal, and they form a circle around Brooks, okay? We create a pocket. Now he can't backpedal and run all over the place. And then, here's the secret. I have Chopsy here. I've been trying to sell Chopsy to that team. Imagine having Chopsy out there knocking the guys off as they come in after him. Now we've got 30 seconds of time. And believe me, don't put Chopsy down, right, Chopsy? Chopsy nods. He says, yes. You know, Chopsy was a great sportsman, buddy. I don't know whether you know anything about his background, but when he was in high school, he was the official javelin and discus catcher. He used to catch the stuff.
Matt, Marcus, I got a question. Mike wrote it to me, and it makes a lot of sense. Do you think Mickey Loomis, you know, watching the ship for Tom Benson, could afford a Chopsy?
Well, you know, he'd have to negotiate with me, buddy. And I'd be very fair. You know, I'd start off by having a couple of drinks with him, and I'd get him the feeling for the good.
Hey, you would pay, right?
Oh, heck no.
Well, so, you ain't gonna have a couple of drinks with him. Okay, all right, see you. Go ahead.
So I tell you what, I could handle it over there, buddy. But you know, we're dealing with something here. There's nothing wrong with this team that a miracle couldn't help. Believe me. And you're talking to the miracle here. I've got the Morgussian solutions. And by the way, buddy, if they would just tune into my website, I've got all the answers there. They can type in the questions. I won't charge a thing. It's free to jump into Morgus.com, and you'll find out that we've got all kind of solutions to all kind of problems. What is that noise I hear? Buddy,
are you the only thing I can see? It must be a Saints practice.
Oh, man, I'll tell you, this is not a scientific program. How can I help you with all that noise, buddy?
Listen, Morgan, the very fact that you responded to our call and everything, I really appreciate it. And listen, I can tell that this is going to be a season where I'm going to have to talk to you as much as you can afford to give us some time.
I can't help you, but I can help those gamblers where you are.
Well, you know, Buddy was very excited after New Orleans Saints finally clinched their first ever playoff win. So let's listen to some of his comments after that remarkable moment on December 30th of 2000.
If the Saints had lost that one, there would have been a suicide watch posted all over the city. Akeem's fumble punt and Brian Milne's recovery at the Ram 10 was poetic justice, in my opinion, because I think the officials were dead wrong in not overturning that rule of an incompletion on Robert Wilson's catch on the play before, and instead would have been a Saints first down instead of forced a Saints punt. I look at the replay a half a dozen times, and I think that Robert Wilson had control of the ball with both hands as he was on the ground. I think it was an incomplete, the call of an incomplete pass should have been overturned, but it wasn't. They didn't, and maybe the good Lord intervened when Akeem fumbled. Aaron Brooks stepped up today and answered all the questions. Aaron Brooks is the real deal. The deal of the NFL season. That trade Randy Mueller pulled off with Green Bay on July 31st is the main reason the Saints have fought their way to their first playoff victory ever. But like a heavyweight champion, the defending champion Rams went down fighting, and they gave us some awful nervous moments. There were so many stars of the Saints today, it'll take time to list them all, but we got time, and we're going to go down the list. And believe me, it's time to party. The party is starting.
Well, many of you might remember Christmas Eve of 1999, Jake DeLone got his first start at quarterback for the Saints in a 31-24 win. And here, Buddy had some interesting comments after the game about Jake DeLone.
I just witnessed what might have been the biggest misevaluation of talent in the history of this franchise, or a situation where the head coach puts personal feelings ahead of what's best for the team. Jake DeLone's performance today verified what's been whispered, sometimes shouted from within the walls of the Saints camp ever since the team came out of training camp, that Jake DeLone had more upside than any quarterback on the Saints roster, and that Jake DeLone was far superior in talent, the ingredient it takes to be an NFL quarterback compared to Denny Werfel, that many players and some of the assistant coaches couldn't believe that at the final cutdown, it was Werfel who stayed and DeLone who was cut. Mike Ditka, in his post-game interview, talked about making a mistake in judgment at that position. It's a mea culpa, but in an organization that there would be accountability, it would not be accepted. Jake DeLone today showed the demeanor, poise, gamemanship, touch on the football, scramble ability, all the factors, the ingredients it takes to play winning quarterback in the NFL. The only thing missing was experience. Sure, Jake DeLone still needs the experience, and sure, Jake DeLone is going to make mistakes, but God, the difference was so obvious today. And we've seen Denny Werfel for 3 years now. How could a head coach make a cut like that on the final cutdown and put this guy on the street? I'll admit, none of the other teams picked him up. Maybe this was the lucky break for the New Orleans Saints. Joe Clark, an old coach that's been around the block for many years, had been the quarterback coach and offensive coordinator at Amsterdam in Germany during the 1998 NFL European season. He had both Kurt Warner and Jake Delhomme under his wing. And he said to anyone who would listen, they battled nip and tuck that season for the starting job. And Warner won it in a photo finish just because he had a little more experience than Delhomme did. Joe Clark has often said, in his opinion, Jake Delhomme was the best quarterback the Saints had. He had Jake Delhomme in Europe, NFL Europe, in the beginning of 1999 season. Imagine a 68-year-old coach getting a few hundred bucks or a few thousand bucks, plying his trade in Europe, having a better understanding about what it takes to play quarterback than Mike Ditka and a $2 million man.
Well, folks, that about wraps up our Buddy D tribute. Goodness knows there's tons of other memories we could put in there, and unfortunately, a lot we just don't have time for. But maybe down the road, we'll get caught up with some more memories as well. While I got the mic in handy, I'd like to tell all of you a brief story about the day Buddy D and David Tyree made me laugh. October of 94, the Saints had just lost to San Diego to go 2-5, and the day after the loss, David, who at the time had a 12 to 1 o'clock show called the Hot Lunch Topic of the Day, asked Buddy D to get on the phone, and the entire hour they pretended that the Saints were 7-0, and that Buddy at 1 o'clock that day was going to lead a parade from the foot of Canal Street holding up a sign that said, Tom Benson's not Mickey Mouse, he's Superman. And the callers got in on the gag, they threw in their own jokes as well, and it turned out to be a pretty funny show to say the least. Well, I'll tell you what, folks, we hope we brought you a lot of happy memories about Buddy and his life and times. He may not have been the perfect broadcaster, but he was rather entertaining. We'd like to close out our show today with a musical tribute to Buddy. This segment is, we basically like to call, Media Heaven. You'll be hearing some voices of past members of the New Orleans media, and right after that, you'll hear Al Hurt actually playing from the floor of Tulane Stadium, a great classic, Auld Lang Syne, followed by Last Date by Floyd Kramer, which, by the way, Buddy also used, he used this particular song to close out his May 2004 tribute to Jim Finks. Thanks for listening to us right here on 640 AM KTIB, and have a pleasant evening. Good night.
My life is as the waters of the river, and I cannot change my course. This is Jim Metcalf.
Probably the most destructive force of any hurricane is the water that it brings along with it. Camille took 20 feet of water inland along the Gulf Coast. And until this time, the record high water for the United States from a hurricane was 15 feet.
Camille will live long in their memories forever. And it is to them that the hearts of all of us go out tonight. Representing the entire staff here at WWL, I'm Bill Elder.
Ever since they came into the National Football League in 1967, that this could be one of the great franchises in the National Football League.
Old wounds heal, old feuds die. You know, football began as an angry gesture born of hate, but it's supposed to be fun. So let's not go back to the year 1042, to that lonely English beach, and start kicking again. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. Top of the evening to you. Here's one for the book.
Well, I got a lot of sports, of course. That's what that's what I'm doing, right? Sports. You wouldn't expect me to give a consumer report, would you, Bob?
Oh, no.
We're going to let you take a look at some action from the two games yesterday in the professional playoffs in Minnesota. What victories was it? We'll take a look at it. I won't tell you.
Bob Krieger, Channel 4 Eyewitness Sports, full auditorium.
Today. All right, folks, that's going to wrap it up on the Point After. Be sure to join us next week, and let's hope the party's just as loud, and it is the victory party. All right, have a good, happy new year, folks. Thank you.